That's close enough to one more minute. So welcome to the session called Surviving the Jump from AAA to Indie. Thank you for being here. Out of curiosity, how many of you have heard of the session during the flash forward this morning? Cool. All right. It worked. Great. So welcome. Thank you for coming. So as I mentioned during flash forward, the idea is basically if you're either a AAA developer who's thinking of doing the leap into indie development, or maybe you have already jumped into indie development and you're sort of trying to figure out your next steps, this session is for you. We're going to share information and sort of our learnings about our own adventures in switching to indie, because you know it's hard. It's hard to start out. I can't speak for the other speakers, but myself, when I was starting an indie studio, so I had no idea how much I didn't know. And thankfully, I had good advice from former coworkers and so on, who were able to sort of tell me, you know, don't do this, do that, and so on. So that's what we're hoping to sort of do in this session, because there is a lot of different things that working in a large studio, maybe we don't necessarily learn things about business, things about marketing that are very new, and they have to be learned quickly. So that's what we're going to do this session. We're going to start with Shawn Alexander Allen talking about the transition into being independent, then Mike Bithell on community, Cliff Harris on business, Borut Pfeifer on publishers, and me on multi-platform. And we're going to have a lot of material, so we're going to go fast, and let's hold Q&A until the very end of the session. So without further ado, Shawn.
Hi. So my name is Shawn. My name is Shawn Alexander Allen. I go by that full name because if you Google Shawn Allen, you get a country music star. But if you Google Shawn Alexander Allen, you pretty much only get me and a guy who's been arrested twice. So I worked at Rockstar Games in New York City for about 4.5 years before going independent in mid-2012. So actually, this is kind of interesting. Before I go on, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention this. It's kind of going on right now. I was actually supposed to be demoing my game in and around GDC and PAX this week, but so this game was, my game Treachery and Beatdown City was funded on Kickstarter last year. I was unable to demo it this week because my programmer that I work with, the one other person that I work with pretty much to build the game from the ground up, had two near-death experiences. One was dental infection, and the other one was he was nearly paralyzed by an anesthesia reaction. So kind of just shows that when you work with one other person, it's like working, it's like building a wall made out of two bricks instead of hundreds. You remove one and the whole wall will fall apart. So yeah, last year I had this game funded. It actually failed right before GDC last year, and I hit the ground running. I'd spent 2 weeks and talking about it, which I really didn't do beforehand. And then a month later, so about 2.5 months straight of running a Kickstarter, and it was successful. And I want to thank everyone who helped make that happen. I wouldn't be here today without that. And you know, as the head of a tiny team, like I do most of the work that isn't programming, music, and some of the production key art. Like I work with Inverse Phase on music, Manuel Marcano on he's a programmer, and the game wouldn't exist without him. And Diana Santiago, she does some of the key art and production art and some of the character design. But I have a lot of things to look at, create, listen to. I have to pretty much sign off on everything, but while running a Kickstarter, I couldn't actually do any of that, so that pretty much held up the entire production on that side. I had to look at builds, but also have to figure out how to get people interested in the Kickstarter. I had to like keep trying to contact press and do all these different things. And it's interesting because, you know, I'm kind of weird. Like the toll of this on my life was super immense, and it kind of made me think, like, do I actually want to do this like in such a small team anymore? But I'm still doing it because I love working on my own projects for myself. And you know, much like in Birdman, the idea of going back to AAA runs through my mind. But at this point, I don't think I could do it, not on AAA's terms. And my Kickstarter was necessary because I don't have that much family or friends that have any money or could help us bootstrap like other people. And we needed to cast a much wider net, hence crowdfunding. And, you know, gaining fans, going to events, meeting people who believe in what you're doing is imperative. So this slide is dedicated to another former Rockstar Games employee, Kara Ellison, who is going to be on the GDC MicroTalks roundtable tomorrow that you should be at, full of amazing people. It's at 11:30. So I worked on a lot of these games when I worked at Rockstar, and in terms of the career that I started, kind of like Drake, like not actually from the bottom, but from the middle, I started at the bottom of the top. You know, Rockstar has immense respect. Like you say, hey, I work at Random Dev animating like stuff for this game, and people are like, whatever. You say, hey, I worked on trailers at Rockstar. They're like, oh, I love those trailers. Like you immediately get this, and it kind of makes people already interested in what you're doing. But the problem is, like, I didn't actually work on any of those games. Like, I wasn't a game developer. I made the trailers for them, and it was very creative, and it was a lot of hard work, and it was really great, and I learned a lot at the company, but I didn't make any games. I learned editing. I learned working with some of the best editors in the industry. I got to write and dialogue and perform dialogue. And most importantly, I developed team leadership skills, working with people of various different skill levels kind of around the game development scene. And, you know, I learned what I learned because I was in an environment that could, you know, you could take some initiative. And that's kind of a hidden prerequisite that if you're going to go on your own, you actually have to take your own initiative to make your own. Like, I had to become a leader among my small group of people in order to help them all out. It helped me in the company, but it also helped me when I got out of there to be able to work with a group of people who all have different talents. And, you know, at the same time, much of my time in the games industry was very shielded from game development. Like, I didn't know what TCRs were. I had to ask. My job didn't hold up the game at all. And in fact, they often would they would optimize the game for our needs. Like if we were needing a gun or something or an animation to look good, they would fix that right then. So it was actually pushing the game forward, and if anything. And our trailers actually made some of the devs really excited about the game. We would get emails about it, and it was pretty cool. So the indie bug kind of bit me really hard, you know, seeing a lot of great games. But as an artist and a writer, not a programmer or anything, I began to think huge and started to work on creating a world and characters for a brawler. And, you know, one day I had the realization that even this was still too big, and I'm still in AAA. And I finally, like, made some, like, pixel art and got it up and running in Game Maker. And I was starting to talk to Manny about working on this game, and he was kind of going through a hard time in his life. And when I finally got it up in Game Maker, he was like, oh, I need to start helping out on this, or else Sean's going to leave me behind. So in order to get my first other team member on, I had to show him that I was actually willing to make the game by myself. So that's actually really good. Like, having something tangible will get people to help you. It was still too big of a project, though, to be my first game, because I had no confidence as a designer, because I was not a designer. I was designing something hoping it was going to be good. So I turned to game jams. The first one I attended was the Global Game Jam 2012 at NYU Game Center, and it almost went too well. I had a diverse team of five talented people. We had three programmers, two people to do art, and two to record sound. You know, we had a lot of overlap, as you usually do. And I was able to flex my, you know, art, rapid concepting, game design, and team management muscles in the project in a very natural way. And I also got to see the cycle of where you think your game is terrible for 99% of the development time until your first playtest after we had to finish and people actually liked it. And then I was like, I actually told people not to come to the playtest session because all we had was garbage, and people actually liked it. We won best overall at the Game Jam site, the same one that Mushroom 11 came out of, that also won an award. And the next day I went into work, still working in AAA, and Evan Narciss had written about it on Kotaku. And then I ran, and I actually went to my first GDC that year, and I ran up to him and I thanked him for writing the article. And that's another good lesson. Like, make free stuff while you're in AAA. If someone writes about it, keep in contact with them because they will be interested in your future career. I mean, we did an article called Video Games Blackness Problem that I was a part of, and it's because I've known him for years and we've been able to introduce other people to him too. My second game jam and subsequent prototyping projects were a lot less successful, but that was kind of par for the course, and it was actually good to just start off and keep working on things and finishing things. And also, your first games don't actually have to really, really be bad. So, I mean, you know, just try to do something. So this is actually interesting. So leaving a mediocre paying job with little savings and shifting the money and responsibility balance in your family and living situation can be very tough. I mean, we talk about, you know, a lot of people have funding or whatever, but like I worked check to check, and but I was like not interested in doing this stuff anymore. Seeing all this creative work, I was just like, I can't stand this. And, you know, but as the shadowy cabal nature of AAA is, I can't really talk about how I left. But I left with minimal severance and some unemployment. New York State actually offered like a self-employment program that allowed me to use unemployment to fund self-employment. And with this stuff being set up, it was interesting because I still had way less money than I had when I was in my job. And even after having a conversation with your partner, things can get difficult. And game dev takes a long time, and unexpected delays and the like can happen, and you have to stretch more. You stretch what little you have more. And, you know, this affected my everyday life. And because of the personal nature, I won't get too deep into this, but, you know, the highs and lows of 2014 actually kind of ended in the dissolution of my marriage. So in a way, you could say part of me did not survive the jump from AAA to indie. I have only like 1 minute left, so... So I'm just going to jump to the end. So in the end, as an indie, you know, it was like bittersweet happiness. Like, well, in AAA, I looked at indie and it was like, oh, you're going to be super happy and you want to make your own passion projects. But as an indie, it's a bittersweet happiness. You know, my destiny is mine, but my failures are mine as well. You can't be too ambivalent about all the criticism you receive, but you also can't beat yourself up over making mistakes. If you have a passion, you can get people to really care about what you're doing, but it will take you throwing your own skin in the game. Success can feel like it's always over the next hill, and after tumbling over multiple hills, it can be exhausting, but you have to keep pushing forward, stay positive, but also practical. And also, if you have zeal, like even if you've never made games before, that's something that you can do. Thank you.
Hey, that's weird. Thomas Was Alone became famous because it was a free game which Evan Arcis wrote about. So meet him. That's a tip. I think I'm next. I hope I'm next. Yes, I am. Woo! Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about community. I guess it's the thing that, if I'm honest with myself, I'm sort of best at. I make good games, like I'm not ashamed of my games, but I think one thing that I've done quite well is talking to a community about my games and interacting with them. I'm illustrating some of these slides with fan art, which is lovely and a little bit egotistical, but it's pretty, so that's fine. So the first point is, this is the first quote, is this is how I know I looked at it, and a lot of people do. If I make a good game, I'll get a community. That's like 10% true. We'll come back to that point throughout, but it's not that easy. I wish it was. Basically, the short version is there are about 10 indie devs in the world that are that good. I'm not going to embarrass myself by naming them because I'll miss someone out. I'm not that good. Statistically, it's unlikely any of you are. It might mean it's possible. So we have to do the other things, which is what I'm going to talk about. The skills that made me a good lead designer in the traditional games industry are not the same skills I use now. There's an overlap, obviously, the game bit, but there's a lot of stuff that I didn't know. I was a cog. I didn't really think about this stuff. So I spent too long being afraid to assume I had fans. Now, I don't know if this is a particularly British issue. I know my American friends have less trouble with this. I find it really uncomfortable to say the word fan and to use that word to describe the hundreds of thousands of people who've played my game. But I just boasted about my numbers, so obviously I'm not the most humble person in the world. it feels awkward. But the problem with that is, while that makes you a nice human being in conversations and makes people want to like invite you out for drinks a bit more often, that humility actually can stand in the way of a lot of the stuff we're talking about. I know my natural inclination is to assume the worst, to assume no one's going to buy volume. Is genuinely something I still find myself saying when I'm talking to colleagues, business partners, potential partners in the platforms and platform world. I say, well, of course, you know, if volume's a flop, and that's fine, and I think that's actually helps us, but at the same time, it limits my thinking. If I'm prepared for being absolutely small and insignificant. And it's dishonest, because I know that I have an audience. I know there are people who've played my games. I know that the chances are a lot of those will want to play my future games. I know that, you know, X number of Twitter followers, this kind of thing. But we have to fight that urge to downplay that. Conservative estimates basically get in the way. We should consider them. We should consider the number of people who are playing our stuff. We should consider that they actually exist. The chances are, you make any game, you're going to have a few fans, at the very least, and that number will only increase. We just need to be realistic, basically, but not take them for granted, which is where we go next. It's a fun journey through these slides. So the first thing I learned very quickly was to give something away. It depends how you think about it. I think, again, we're very conservative and very limited in our thinking often, that we go, well, I need the money now. I was in a very fortunate position. I had a day job which covered my rent and bills. That's a massive privilege and one that a lot of devs don't have. But I'm assuming, given the subject of this talk, a lot of you are in that boat, that you're kind of getting by, the mortgage is getting paid. This is something you're maybe thinking of doing in your spare time, or at least kind of starting in your spare time and then moving over. I know that one thing I did very early was, everyone who bought the game before Steam, so a few thousand people, so this was people who bought it direct and on Azure, I gave them a free key. That's the email that I sent out to people, kind of thanking them for buying the game and encouraging them to spend the money they would have spent buying it on Steam to go and buy another indie game, which is the kind of saccharine bullshit that I enjoy writing. It's true, I am really that cheesy, but I'm not faking it. really, I'm not. But it was something that immediately made, I got loads of thank you emails. And it didn't make sense to me that I would get people to pay. I did an interview earlier today about volume, and one of the questions was, is the game cross-buy? If I buy the game on PlayStation Vita, do I also get on PS4? And it just seemed silly to me. Of course you do. You've already given me your money. I don't need more of your money. I'd like more of your money, and by all means, you know. But at the same time, like, it just struck me as very odd. These random acts of kindness pay off with unintended consequences. They don't always pay off. A great example I always go back to, while I'm closing my notes by accident there we go, is I saw on Reddit, someone tweeted an image of Thomas Was Alone's Steam page with the caption, "My name is Tom," and this just freaked me out, because I'm alone in the dark in my house, and it freaked me out. So I wrote him, and this was a bit fake, I wrote him kind of a faux apology for upsetting him. I wrote him kind of, you know, obviously it was not my intention to make you uncomfortable sitting in the dark alone. Here's a free key for the game. That was on Reddit, the front page of Reddit for a day, that email, because funny stuff works and people got into it. That doesn't mean that we all need to now target Reddit by sending emails to everyone who posts about our game. But sometimes these things work. Sometimes these approaches work. It's rare. The point is, you have to do a lot of silly things for one of them to work. And you don't need to be in control. So this is something that I think and this is definitely something I'm aware of, is I'm used to the way marketing works in AAA, because that was what I had the most awareness of. So things like, you have to set up a forum. Why? Like, seriously, why do I have to, like, for a big game, I guess it's useful. You can sell ads and you can localize stuff. But the goals of a big company are very different to my goals. It makes no sense at all for me to try and centralize my community or own my community or set up a website where my community gather. Because my community are a million people who've played a game for 2 hours. They're not a community in that sense. I'm not going to create a Facebook equivalent for the Thomas Was Alone fan base. Now, that thinking, even things like wiki pages, so this is completely unlicensed wiki. We're doing something similar with the same site for volume, where I'm going to provide some help to them, but ultimately, it's not owned by me. And it's the best thing ever. I actually use this website now to check story details if Thomas was alone before doing interviews, genuinely, or when answering questions. I actually check this page to get the spellings of some of the characters right. Not the main characters. Those are all, you know, first names. I'm not a child. But, like, the other characters in the backstory. It's useful. And that's because I don't own it, because I wouldn't have made a resource as good as this one. It's also a way to put people off. It's very children's TV presenter to want to kind of corral your audience and look after them and tell them where to go and what to do. It's a bit creepy. And it's especially creepy. Big companies can get away with it because it's a big company. But when you're just Mike Bithell from London and you're sending emails to people asking them to go and sign up to a website so they can hang out with you, it's creepy. It's weird. The kind of unique kind of thing about indies that we get to be individuals makes this stuff odd. Don't do it. And look after those individuals. So more fan. I love this fan art because this fan art is about the meta story that's kind of hidden in Thomas, not hidden, but there in Thomas Was Alone, that a lot of people don't notice that it's existing on a computer. And I love that image. It's beautiful. I want to make that game next. I'm not going to make that game next. That was not an announcement to any journalists in the room. Please don't. So at the start, we can treat an audience well. So when you're first starting out, when your game's kind of getting out there, it's going to be small, unless you make something that just goes massive overnight. But again, those are so rare, they're almost not worth discussing. You're probably going to start small, which means you can really look after each user. You can really, like, and I did, like, those first few thousand players of Thomas Was Alone, I followed them all on Twitter. We had chats. They could send me questions about levels they were stuck in. I'd reply to them. That was possible at that stage. It quickly became impossible to actually maintain that and eat and live and hang out with people and sleep. That's the order of my priorities, apparently. I did that off the cuff, and that's very telling. It's always useful to make psychological breakthroughs in front of an audience. Thank you very much. But as things got bigger, that got harder, and I had to learn to deal with that stuff. What I found was basically I kept in touch with a lot of those early people. I still follow a lot of them on Twitter and chat to them. It becomes a case of engaging more generally in a friendly way with your community. I'm going to have to rush because I've over ad-libbed here. It's okay to be a name. This is another thing. I'm kind of annoyed. Like, I'm wearing a Thomas Was Alone t-shirt right now. I'm someone who kind of puts myself out there. I'm very visible, very noisy. I decided I had to do that because my games are not good enough for me not to do that. Like I said, there's those 10 developers who can be shy because they're geniuses. I'm not. Statistically, you're not. So therefore, we have to actually be okay with putting ourselves out there. Now, I wrote this slide about 4 months ago in more naive times, before a lot of the more obvious recent stuff that's been going on. I don't want to say the word. It's weird. It's like Candyman. But basically, it's horrible. And this slide becomes harder to convince. If you are someone who's worried about having negative, horrible stuff sent to you, and you should be because that's human, and it's not cowardly to be scared of that stuff, there are ways around it. You can create a persona. That's what I do. I'm not the same on Twitter as I'm in real life. I have separate areas of my life. You can also create an alternative character. There are at least, I can think of one very specific game developer that doesn't exist, is on Twitter, has more followers than me, but is a fake human being. And this is the last note, because all of that, about all the marketing and stuff, it's also important to have a good game. Bad games don't have fans. You can do all of that. If your game's not working, it's not going to work. The other guys will give you better advice than me on how to make good games, though. Thank you for your time. I've got to run because I've overrun. Thank you.
Okay. Right, here we go. If you're just like wondering who on earth I am, I'm basically the guy that made Democracy and the gratuitous space battles, tank battles, games, stuff like that. And I have a blog that a lot of people read and talk about. Half of this talk is very practically how it feels and what happens when you go from AAA to indie. The other half is kind of like general, what it's like to be indie stuff. And I've done the sort of like quit my job and go indie twice, because the first time I ran out of money and had to get a job. Ironically, that's the job I got was in the AAA. So I've kind of experienced it twice. Okay, this is my kind of like artist impression, as it were, of how it actually feels when you go indie. You should be really panicked and scared. because if you look around EDC, you see how many other people are like making games, and it is quite a tough business. One of the big problems I had, it kind of depends where you're from, but I live in some tiny little village where I'm the young person, believe it or not, who like understands computers. So I don't have this like community of people to talk to about my game. And if you work in AAA, you're used to talking about the game with everyone all the time. If you then suddenly go to being indie, like literally working in your bedroom, then you, it kind of like depends on your circumstances, but you may have no one to talk to about the game. And that is suddenly very weird and very different. It is perfectly natural for your parents to think that you're wasting your life. This is perfectly normal. And it's also very natural for people that you used to work with to say that you're nuts and you're doomed. They don't do this as much since Minecraft, because there's kind of like obvious counterexamples. And they're not kind of being cruel, and they're not doing it maliciously. It's just if you've decided to do it and they haven't, obviously they want to feel good about their decision to kind of like stay within AAA, so you do kind of get a skewed opinion there. It is very important to sort of get out there and meet other indies, because like I say, you don't have this support group anymore. You have to accept the fact that you may fail and end up with no money and have to get a job flipping burgers. I mean, that just is the reality. I would say probable, actually. And if you can't handle that, then don't do it, frankly. You also have to realize that suddenly you're a small businessman or woman, and you may find it hard to identify with like the problems that your buddies in AAA have. This seems ridiculous, but I think one of the most important things about going indie is getting a good office chair. Nobody really thinks about it, but if you had like a similar kind of job, in terms of like you're a one-man band or two-man band or whatever, and you're a plumber or an electrician, you wouldn't kind of balk at buying a decent van, because like, you know, that's just the cost of doing business. And having decent equipment and a decent office, even if it's like a home office, and a comfortable chair to sit in, you know, that's, you need that. And yes, you can justify it. It doesn't have to be thousands, but like not a $20 chair. And if you're in your 20s, you can shake it off, but as you get older now, you need a good chair. Archery. I know it sounds ridiculous, but the sport for you is archery. And I know that just sounds like some crazy English guy that lives in a field saying that. I actually really love archery, but one of the kind of like motivations for doing it is if you get into archery, you have to stand up absolutely straight, you have to concentrate, and you have to stare at something a long way away. And that is the complete opposite of game development. So it's, you know, it is just really good for you. You know, it gets you outside as well. This is kind of the change that a lot of people kind of can't cope with. They don't think about the money. They get caught up in a very kind of like GDC positive, I'm making a game and it's cool and I'm following my dreams and it's going to be so artistic. But actually there's a load of kind of businessy stuff. Suddenly you need decent hardware and you need licenses. I'm one of these smug people in England that doesn't have to, you know, pay for healthcare. Woo! I know we pay for it. But suddenly you have to worry about that stuff. And, you know, Breaking Bad teaches me that it can all go tits up if you don't have healthcare. So suddenly you need to worry about that. You need to worry about the corporation tax rate and stuff like that. This is a slide kind of from a talk I did a long time ago that just like breaks down the numbers of how much money you need in terms of game sales to actually have enough money to live on. And so I kind of like looked up in the UK what the sort of average income is. And if you like scale it up and take away all this other stuff and you're making one game a year and it always does well and makes money and you're never ill and you never have to take time off or whatever, then yeah, you definitely need to gross at least $100,000 a year. And I know people talk about making huge amounts of money, but actually selling $100,000 worth of games is actually really hard. I also like publish indie games, so I get pitches, and most of them absolutely hilariously bad. most of the game ideas are good. The games look good. You know, the programmers are talented. The people have talent. But then when they get to like the business slide, if there is one, it's often just like funny if you've been in the industry a long time. The marketing budget is always zero because they're indies and they're like guerrilla and a bit woo and a bit wee and like they don't need to do any advertising or anything like that. And they stupidly think that a team of people who can make a really good, successful piece of software are all gonna like work in coffee shops and like sleep on the floor and eat noodles and stuff like that. And that's really romantic for the first week, but like after a year, no, everyone will quit. Everyone will go and work for, you know, some bank. So you have to budget for that. You really do. Yeah, and also, if you're going to go to GDC, it's hellishly expensive. If your plans are, I don't need a marketing budget, I'm just going to go to GDC and network, well, you know, you've got flights and hotels, and if you live in Europe, you know, that's going to cost you a small fortune. And one way of thinking about this is if you are an electrician, you have, for example, and you are kind of like an electrician, you are a small business, and they have all these costs that it just goes without saying that they're going to have to spend this stuff, and game developers seem to think that they won't need any tools, they won't need an accountant, they won't need all this boring stuff, but you do. Okay, this is, I keep pimping this book, and I keep pimping it so much that I really should have shares in it or something, but it is a really good book. And that book is kind of just there for people that think advertising doesn't work. It does, it's one of those things where it just does. If you disagree, I'm afraid you are just wrong, and you need to read that book. If you know it works or you will accept that it works, but you're not really sure how, there's another book called Seducing the Subconscious, because adverts don't work the way you think they do. And it does work for indie game developers. People think that it doesn't, but it does. But it is quite technical. You have to know about what you're doing. Advertising used to be like Mad Men. Maybe it's not anymore, and it's incredibly technical. And you will just burn your money if you don't really look into how to do it. A few other bits. This is why I do strategy games at $20 or more, because I can advertise them and it makes sense. If you're making like a $5 game, don't advertise. I don't know how you're going to sell that. I just have no idea. Maybe you'll get lucky. I don't know. But you won't do it with this model. You cannot track advertising. You can track it a bit, and there's loads of companies here, and I'm sure there are loads of talks about analytics, and that's great, and go to those talks and learn all about it, but you cannot track it 100%. And that puts people off. That puts geeks off. They hate it. They say, I've spent this amount, and I can't track that it was worth it. But they're at GDC. And when you say to them, why are you at GDC? Are you sure you got value from that? They're like, probably, it must have done. And they would do that, but they won't take that same risk on spending money on advertising. But it's the same kind of thing. It's an investment in, you know, PR, marketing, your game. This is me just sort of like pimping advertising again, really. So it's quite easy to look up how much you've spent on Google AdWords, which is why that's on there, but I don't think it's even the majority of the money that I've spent on advertising. These are just stats that nobody tells anyone. So when you look at your stats, if you do some advertising and you sort of think, is this shit? I have no idea. You can Google it. Nobody like shares stats like this. So it's quite important just to kind of like know what at least one other person's stats were. One of the things that I really like about advertising is it's guaranteed coverage, and it's the only guaranteed coverage you can ever get. If you want to be on the front page of Rock, Paper, Shotgun next week, it's easy. If you've got the money. And obviously that's a real pain and it's a real nightmare, but you can guarantee it, and you cannot with anything else. You have to have charisma and know people and, like, you know, have an amazing game and all this other stuff, and still you have to hope for the best. But the reason that a lot of people advertise is if you pay someone to have a banner ad or whatever for your game, then it will definitely be there. And that's kind of quite reassuring. You know your game won't be ignored. Obviously, the downside is you have to find the money for it. So, yeah, it is quite scary if you kind of like look at some of these sums about how much money I'm suggesting people spend to promote their game. And I'm only saying it because, you know, it works. Okay, I'm running out of time, and that's it. Thank you very much.
Borut, and I'll start with a little bit about myself. Back in 2001, I went indie before it was like actually that's what it was called. There were four of us, and we were trying to build a demo and pitch it to publishers, building our own engine, all this sort of folly. And we eventually ran out of money, and I went to work for Radical, and then Sony Online, and EA. And eventually I left EA as it was kind of like in the middle of canceling projects in like 2009, and started working on Skulls of the Shogun in collaboration with 17-bit. And so with Skulls, we eventually signed a deal with Microsoft to publish on Xbox 360, Windows 8, Windows Phone, and then we self-published on all the other platforms, and we're coming out on PS4 in a few months. So I'm here to talk about publishers and give you my wisdom over that whole time frame, all the meetings I've had with them and the relationships I've had with them, how to deal with them. It's not just the basic, like, okay, they'll take a cut of your profits that hinders your ability to sustain your business. It's also the fact that you think that they will bring, like, their business and, you know, marketing skills to the table, but the reality is you will need to learn to do those things anyway. So you really have to look hard at what they're saving you and what they're bringing to the relationship. So there's two main kinds right now, anyway, in terms of publishers. The platform owners, the Microsofts, the Sonys of the world. And you think of these, okay, they have a solid user base. They have channels to promote to their users, that kind of thing. But in reality, it's more like this. There's so many platforms. They're all overcrowded. The value of getting a feature on any one of them has just gone down from day one on all of them, pretty much. And so you think, well, okay, they're promotional-only publishers, and they have, you know, the PR skills, the business skills that you might lack, and you feel like, you know, you have the game-making skills, you can bring those together, that'd be great. But in reality, 90% of them are more just like they're just sort of leech value and not really adding value right now in the industry. And so I'll talk more about that in a second. But the third is sort of the more elusive, like, development funding publisher, and there's not a lot of them. And I would have had a picture of a unicorn, but like Cliff said, he actually does a little bit of that, so it's not entirely true. But it's pretty rare, and some of the logic and the rules and advice I'll give kind of apply to those two from each category. So obviously, with a platform-owning publisher, you get some dev funding, you get on their platform, and they usually want exclusivity or like highlighting their features. With Skulls of the Shogun, Microsoft liked that we could play asynchronously across the PC and the console and the tablet and the phone, all these things, and that was what they wanted. And so, you know, in terms of, you know, you think of exclusivity and it's like, oh no, you don't want to give that away. But in reality, there's a certain amount of time it will take for you to port your game to the next platform. And giving away exclusivity under that time is basically free to you. And they will give you money for that, which is great. So on the flip side, if they want more exclusivity, you can tie that to, you know, higher sales amounts. So if you sell really well on their platform, enough to sustain their business, they get more exclusivity. So it turns out to be a more fair arrangement. And one more thing to think about when big companies are making new platforms. There's always a business opportunity there and sometimes a creative opportunity, but the reality is it's a big company like trying to do something innovative, and so there's even more sort of gear grinding and bureaucracy you might have to deal with, and that's definitely time beyond just like the tech development of working with beta software and that kind of thing. Now with promotional-only publishers, I've seen a bunch of contracts that they'll hand you just to start, and it's like, they'll take a certain percentage of your royalties for no guaranteed marketing, like no marketing budget, no specified amount. It's like, well, how about we just leave an unspecified amount of royalties in that contract? So the real question to you is like, you know, what can they commit to in writing? Because you might think they are essentially being rewarded if the game does well, if they promote it. You know, the more they promote it, the more it sells, the more money they make. But in reality, they're actually rewarded for signing like 10 indies. They don't have to do much work. One of them hits, and they make money from that. So the system isn't really set up right now in the current state of the industry for that to sort of foster. So yeah, you have to look at what can they commit to in writing. And you might think, well, what, you know, these things are sort of amorphous. But no, like going to a show like PAX has specific travel costs. Buying online advertising has specific costs. So if they can't build a marketing budget and show it to you, then they probably don't know how to market your game. And so really be extremely skeptical of any sort of, you know, claims of their promotional ability. Something else you also want to consider is like actual spending caps. And you might think, oh, let them spend all they want. But the reality is if they're spending money ineffectively, then that's coming out of your bottom line. And you need to be like, you need to have some kind of input in that process. And just towards the overall negotiation process, you know, it's an old adage, but being able to walk away. And you might go into it and you might think, you've got to get this money. It's the only way you're going to make your game. But if you can't talk yourself out of that, you will just put yourself in a position where you accept a deal that will really impact your life, you know, negatively and stressfully, and it will not be worth it, I guarantee it. And so you want to find what they want, what's your leverage, what's unique about you that you can then use to kind of be creative and figure out their needs and come to a creative solution in terms of things. So stuff like sliding exclusivity scales. And I've done this before myself. I've seen many friends do it. Never chase money. Like whenever a publisher asks you to change something in a pitch or a demo and they're doing it for free without a contract in your hand, just don't do it. Like that's the big, big red flag. I've seen people like just keep doing that, keep chasing it, keep making tweaks for a particular, you know, partner, and it just never appears visually, you know, comes together. Anyway, so definitely, you know, keep that as a sign of a red flag. And lastly, just understand that you're going to be dealing with two or three biz dev people. They're going to hand that off to their legal team, which is potentially tens, if not hundreds, of lawyers. And they're going to give you back a boilerplate contract, which will not include anything that you talked about. And you have to go back to them and be like, we talked about X, Y, and Z, and then they'll put it in the contract. Don't be offended. Don't be pissed off. It's just a sort of a side effect of the organizational structure. So in the future, we'll definitely see more promotional-only publishers. You know, we'll see YouTubers are effectively becoming publishers. The successful ones will kind of build a name for themselves and what they promote. Folks like Devolver Digital do a great job. You can see them, like the games they promote. You can see where they promote them and how they promote them. And now Let's Players are basically taking royalties of games for like set numbers of videos. And that's a great sort of equation in the sense that you know how many subscribers they have, you know what percentage they're going to take, how many videos they're going to make, and you can estimate how much your game's going to make and decide if that number of impressions is worth it to you for that cost. And lastly, just some parting advice. So, you know, like I said, all those sort of skills, selling your own game, business development, you're going to have to learn those on your own regardless. And so what the publisher really brings to the table, you know, you really have to kind of look at what demonstrable value they can bring. And so, you know, if you really absolutely do need external money to fund the game, like really question yourself and like, how can you scope it down? How can you make it without that money? Is there any sort of, you know, game in that range that is feasible? And like I said, you're going to have to sell your own game anyway and do your own business development. So, yeah, what do they bring to the table?
Yeah. All right. Now time for the last session. And that's me on... time for the last session, and that's me on multi-platform PC and mobile development. So what I want to talk about in this session is basically the question of what do we do about mobile? If you're starting a new project or you're thinking of starting a new project coming from AAA, we're kind of familiar with either PC or console development. We're familiar with the market. We're probably gamers, so we kind of know how, you know, press works and so on. But what about mobile, right? I mean, it's a huge market. We all know the stats about how many millions of devices there are out there. We've all heard about Supercell or King making unknown millions of dollars a day, probably. Do we try to do this? So the background is that I come from, you know, EA, Three Rings, Zynga, sort of large mid-sized companies, mostly PC development, web and console a little bit. Then decided to go indie. We released a game called 1849, which was a simulation strategy game on PC and tablet last year, this time. And that was actually really interesting. It was a premium title, so, you know, pay once, play as much as you want, not a free-to-play game. So I'm going to be sharing some of the lessons from that. Just to start with conclusions, and we'll sort of unpack them a little bit, I think at this point I wouldn't do a mobile-only indie title. I mean, honestly, I think that ship has sailed. If you do a premium game that's mobile only, it's too risky because your sales are completely dependent on getting featured or getting a good word of mouth, both of which are very difficult. And without them, you're dead in the water. But free-to-play is too expensive for an indie developer. I mean, buying ads is how you get players, and ads are expensive. But I think there is hope in cross-platform development. So if you start with PC, or maybe console, but I'll talk about PC mainly, that is something that you know that we know how to do. We know how to build up that audience, and we can use that to then improve our chances on mobile and to make the game sort of larger and available to more players. And yeah, you will have to adapt the game, redo the UI, that kind of stuff, but I think it's worth it because who doesn't want a larger audience, right? Going mobile plus PC means more players, means more discussion, means more word of mouth, buzz. It also means diversifying your revenue sources, so you're not depending solely on your Steam sales or your iOS sales or whatever. And that's always good. Here's our stats for 2014 for the game that I mentioned before. 41% of that sold on Steam, 40% sold on mobile, iOS and Android combined. That's a huge chunk of the sales, right? It would be a shame not to do that. But as I mentioned, it has to work with the design, right? It has to work not just with the UI, not just making the swipe feel correctly or whatever, but also with how you approach the players and how you approach what they expect, because your mobile players are going to be different from your PC players. Mobile players, I'm going to stereotype this right now, but they're more casual, they're more occasional. They're going to be maybe getting game recommendations from their family or friends, but they typically are not going to be seeking out your title as much as PC games. PC gamers are enthusiasts, they're into their hobby, they are opinionated, and they know what they like. Also, some of them will react poorly to what they think are mobile ports, so that's something to keep in mind. Because these are different audiences and they value different things, you not only have to change your UI and UX to meet their expectations, but you also have to change your communication style, which is something we actually failed to do with our game. And now we've learned, and we're going to do it for our next game, which is you need different product stories because your mobile audience is going to value accessibility and short play sessions, and your PC audience is going to be a little bit more hardcore. They're going to value different things. So different store descriptions, different YouTube videos, different artwork, different screenshots. Your entire story needs to be tailored to the audience. So if you do go with PC and mobile, what kind of a revenue model do you do? I would say premium is easy because it matches sales on Steam or one of those stores. So it's easy, right? Just pay for the game once and you're done. One thing to keep in mind, though, is that it's hard to scale the revenues up in a premium model as you grow your studio because you are going to be capped at some level. We've all heard about Monument Valley, for example. Beautiful game, super popular and justifiably so. I think they were recently reported as making some number of millions of dollars in lifetime revenue. Now, that's lifetime, right? And they, all the stars aligned for them. They got Game of the Year awards. They got multiple featuring by Apple. I mean, it was perfect. By definition, there's only going to be one Game of the Year per year, right? Most of us are not going to be that lucky, even if we make good games. So we have to keep in mind that without all of that stuff coming together, we're probably looking at maybe hundreds of thousands, if we are unlucky, tens of thousands of dollars in lifetime revenues on premium on mobile. So that's not a, not to scare anybody, but it's kind of a realistic thing. Which is, again, going back to, well, if we combine that with PC, that's a different story. Free-to-play, I don't think it's a feasible thing for indies because you're going to be going up against big players who spend a lot of money to acquire users, and we don't have that kind of money. I mean, unless if you're running a startup that's already venture-funded, then you can ignore the rest of the stuff. You're in a completely different league. And if you're looking at ads as a revenue source, there are some recent... there are some recent good examples of that, but historically they have not been worth it too much. You have to have a huge viral hit for that to work, and those are very rare. If you do go with premium, picking a price point is going to be difficult, and there's no good solution to this, basically because your anchoring on PC is high, and unfortunately, on mobile it is not, right? On mobile, $5 game is expensive. People will not like to pay that. If you're Minecraft or if you're Final Fantasy, you can charge $8, right? And like, that's not, you know, compared to the cost of developing it, that's a kind of a different story. So you're typically people go with this tiered approach where they do one price on PC and another price on mobile. And yes, there will be a fraction of your PC players who are going to be upset by this because they will see this as you making a $5 game and then charging them $15. They're not thinking of it as it's a $15 game that has to be discounted on mobile. So just keep this in mind. Maybe one solution to this is to make something different about the PC game that justifies a higher price point. Getting the word out is also interesting in the mobile world. On PC, on console, we kind of know how that works, right? We know how to talk to the press. We know what press is interested in. We know that gamers read and interact with gaming media, YouTube, all of that stuff. In mobile, it's different. From my experience and from reading player surveys, the two biggest drivers for purchase of a premium game on mobile are store featuring and word of mouth. And store featuring is a complete crapshoot because you will not know whether you're going to get featured until you've already made the game. And then word of mouth is just difficult to get because it depends on people knowing each other and talking about your game. Ads, I don't think, work very well for premium. People have been habituated to when they click on an ad for a game that's going to be a free game, and they're going to bounce when they discover you're asking them to pay. And review sites are not as influential as on the PC side, again, because mobile gamers are not hobbyists in the same way that PC gamers are. So they will, you know, they will read less, maybe, review sites and they're just a different audience. So once again, if you do a PC version first, then you can build up your PC fan base based on the ways you know about, get people excited, and then use that to promote your mobile game. And then one last word is about getting featured, because it is a crucial thing in getting your game out. Basically, it's not black magic, right? Platforms look for games that will showcase the quality of their platform. So, of course, you have to have a quality game, right? I'm patting myself on the back because we got featured by both Apple and Google. But you don't wait to be discovered. Platforms do have biz dev people who are looking actively for games to feature. Find your own biz dev people who will represent you. There are contractors who do business development who, just like book authors agents, in the way that authors agents represent authors to publishers, same way people will represent you to Apple and Google. Find them, hire them, and don't wait to be discovered. Seek it out yourself. So that's the end of my slides. Thank you very much. And that's our talk. And now let's do some Q&A. If you'd like to come up to the mics in the middle, if you have questions for a particular person, please ask them by name. Otherwise, you can just ask at all of us. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you for the talk. That was awesome. I find that for me personally, one of my biggest struggles is still working in the AAA and just trying to work on my own projects, because professionally I'm an engineer, but I'm trying to work on my design skills through my side projects. There's this constant tension of trying to work on my projects outside of work and burning out very quickly because, you know, I'm working AAA full-time all day, and so it's hard to find the time and energy to work on the side projects, and yet needing those side projects to partly to prepare myself to do design work on my own stuff, and also to have projects ready to work on as soon as I take the plunge. So I was wondering if you guys had any thoughts on just kind of dealing with that inherent tension.
I had to actively, we were maybe in crunch when I did the Global Game Jam, and I said, I'm not coming in this weekend, and I did the Global Game Jam. I mean, I'd say, like, call in sick on Friday of the Global Game Jam and just hang out all weekend and make a game.
Personally, I was very lucky in that my last company I worked at for 2 years while I made Thomas Was Alone were aware of Thomas Was Alone. It had kind of gotten a name for itself at that point. But still, I was going home and working every night. All I can advise was I found that what worked for me was doing something that was so different, so vastly separated from what I was doing at work, actually made it a hobby. So Thomas Was Alone was you know, specifically a game that had nothing to do with, I was making social games by day at that point. I was working on, you remember Facebook games? They were awesome. remember GDC like 3 years ago? Funny times. So I was doing that stuff by day. So for me, like going home and making a platform was just like, it was a hobby. It was different enough that it felt interesting. The other thing I would suggest as well is you specifically describe your skills, play to your skills, especially with a project now, because you haven't got time. It's all, you know, we should always push ourselves, but push yourselves within criteria. You know, if you're not, like for me, I knew I was a graphic designer who was a decent level designer and could write for a bit, and therefore designed a game that was entirely about those skill sets so that I didn't hit those walls, because the walls are what kills it. The walls, when you hit that wall and it's like, I need to go and learn how to do something, that's the point where suddenly watching Breaking Bad box sets just seems like a better play, you know?
Okay. Thank you.
I'd just add to that, I think, just go home on time, you know. Even if you're in the like AAA industry and everyone's like, oh, you have to work really late, everyone works late. And I've been there when I've walked out and everyone is still in the room coding. And I just think, well, I don't care.
But be prepared, because I've been in that position, be prepared for everyone to hate you. Yeah. Like, and, no, I know I have this cavalier way. Genuinely, like, be prepared to be the arsehole in the office who doesn't stay, because I had to make that choice. And it, you know, burnt some bridges. Some people didn't like me because, you know what, Mike's gone. It's 5 o'clock. Mike's gone. That was a choice I had to make. It's a hard choice, especially like if things had gone the other way and the game hadn't worked out.
Hi, my name is Stephanie. Question for you: going from AAA to indie, team sizes change, right? So, what are your like takeaways on? Is there any role that, you know, going from those big teams to small team, you felt, oh my God, those were irrelevant when we had them on big AAA titles. What I'm looking for is any strategies to, like, reduce teams. One of the other way around is you have some AAA teams that are looking at the indie guys, like, wow, you did this in three guys, you know? And we have 15 guys, and we can't even reach that. So any, like, now that you've seen both sides,
so
reflection
with,
on that?
With Skulls of the Shogun, the three of us that started working on the game, we were all multidisciplinary. Like, two, like, programmers, designers, and one, like, artist designer, so we could wear all of those hats. And we were also, you know, advanced and self-motivated, so we didn't really need a producer for a long time because we were all just sort of on top of tracking that ourselves. And we'd also, like, you know, thankfully, we'd also worked remotely before, so we knew how to kind of, like, stay in touch and, like, keep on it without having to be, like, super regimented, which saved us a lot of time.
The other thing, and I think this is sneaking up, and I think everyone needs to take advantage of this, because those of us who are making games, big games at small budgets are doing this, and no one's talking about it, it doesn't have to be one job, one company, one team, one person, ever. There is amazing support industry starting to grow, which is people who do creative jobs that take roughly a 10% of development are making 10 games a year. People like my sound engineer is working on about 8 games coming out next year. My composer's working on a couple because that's a bigger job. You can work out ways to structure this. The biggest problem medium-sized to big companies have is the dude sat at the desk who's not got anything to do. That we need to not repeat that mistake because we haven't got room to do that. Treat it in a fair way. Pay people well if they're part-time because they may be out of work, you know, and you've got to make sure everyone's safe and comfortable and happy and you're not screwing anyone over. But work with those people. I have an animator who's working on 3 games. He is making much, much more money from working 3 freelance gigs that are the same hours as his old job, working full-time. He's happy. I'm happy because I'm not paying him to keep him at his desk, and everyone's winning. He gets to put his and it's great for him as well because if one of those 3 games he's working on is a hit, he gets to walk around GDC as the guy who animated that game you've heard of, and he'll just like not mention the other two. So it's great for everyone, and everyone's doing it, but we're not talking about it because we're pretending we have these massive offices because we think we have to because we think that's the way to get respect from the bigger companies. You know, nest it. Work out a way to be like the film industry, basically. Bring in people who need it. I'm sorry, I'm getting waved off.
All right. I apologize, though. We are running out of time, but please come over to the podium, or we'll go to the spill out room, and we're done. Thank you very much. Thank you.